pushing the button again.
Okay.
Starting that whole thing over. Dramatic lightning. Pushing the button. Full house today. Wow. Everybody got that?
Jeez Louise.
Going again. Roll it. There we go. Now, are you excited, Mrs. Ryan? Take two.
Still nervous. I mean, that really helped.
There we go. All right. Bring it in here. Come on in the studio. Boy. Hello, everybody. Hello.
Hello.
Hi, Mrs. Ryan.
Hi.
I'm happy to be doing a show back with you here.
Me too.
It's only been, I guess we did almost every day last week, but right up to the end there, and it felt like 3 days off. Seems like we haven't done this in a million years.
I know. Same here.
Busy morning also.
I mean... It's just,
you know what? I may go back to the coffee. So, because I didn't have any this morning, and we have had a day already.
Yeah.
It's great, though. All right, I'm really excited because of the name that everybody saw up there. TONI FISHMAN is here from Telefunken. Finally, we can talk all about Telefunken. And then beyond that, like I said, we've had a day already. I went and got new tires on yellow car.
What day is it?
Oh shit! We haven't even started the show. I was going to get to that. Trying about all the stuff I did before. Welcome back, everybody. Today is Tuesday, January 22nd, 2019. My name is Jay Ryan. This is Nicole Ryan. We are the Ryans, and it's tonight's show. That's right. It's tonight's show. We're trying new things.
What a day.
We're trying new things.
Yeah, I love it.
I hate saying, and this is It's Tonight's Show, because then it's more, you know what I mean? It's kind of like it's overselling the it's.
Yeah.
But it's tonight's show.
Great.
Hey, everybody, that's okay. It's tonight's show. Relax. It's tonight's show. Take it easy. It's tonight's show. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
I'm sensing a new... I think we're birthing a new ad campaign, perhaps.
Cool.
Relax. Ellipsis. It's tonight's show.
Cool. I like it. I'm going to make t-shirts.
You're going to have snots coming out of my nose here. Hell of a day.
Oh, man.
Hell of a day. Shall we get it right on started here, Mrs. Ryan? I'd like to do the hellos.
Okay.
Because I have two things I'd like to talk about. Do you have anything to talk about for the hellos?
No, I'm so nervous. I'm going to stop saying that, but that's my hello note.
Are you more nervous because TONI from Telefunken is here or because we have a vlogger in the house
Here's
as well?
The deal.
Jordan, what's your vlog? What's your address? How do people find you?
Days with Jordan the Lion on YouTube, and it's D-A-Z-E.
Days with Jordan the Lion on YouTube, and it's Days Z-E.
D-A-Z-E.
Yeah, Z-E.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. So do you know which one it is? Are you more...
I think Jordan. No offense, TONI, but I think Jordan for
sure. We're not used to having like camera people here, and there's like a guy with a camera.
And I was telling you before, like I'm used to dealing with not awesome people in that line of work sometimes from my old life, and he's
because of the level of talent you used to work with, people were always trying to get
for whatever reason. The people that were doing the videotaping, the vlog, and the interview stuff were not always as gracious and loving as this man has been, and like I'm so tickled and blown away by the whole bit. I think it's making me nervous.
Mrs. Ryan, I love it, and I appreciate you being honest.
Thanks.
Sharing it with everybody.
Well.
All right, then I want to talk about two things. One, the Grand Tour is back. Hallelujah.
Oh, man, that's awesome.
For me, it's a big deal. I miss those guys.
Yeah, same.
You know what I mean? The show is the show, but I miss the guys. Because when they're not on the show, they're making the show. And then, you know, they're somewhere else.
Yeah, I miss them too.
We watched the first episode the other day. I thought it was great. I thought it felt like the old Top Gear. What did you think?
Yeah, that's a really good description. It did feel like the old Top Gear.
By that, I mean there was no hoopla. Everybody just showed up for work and did their car show. You know what I mean? There was no
pomp and
circumstance and expectations, and it cost this much money and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
The tent's going to be where? There was no hoopla. It was just blah, blah, blah. Here's our guys. Here's what they do best.
And they had fun with it. And it
they looked like they were having a good
time. Yeah.
You're right. I think that's it.
It made it really fun to be part of when you watched it.
Yeah. That makes a difference.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. And with that, I'm going to play one other clip. Or I'm going to play a clip of one other show that also just got released on Amazon Prime this weekend.
Oh, no.
I'm very excited about
it. I'm so excited.
I was watching it in bed late last night, and I texted this to Mrs. Ryan because I thought it was great. So see if you can figure out what show it is, and if not, I'll tell you after. Roll it, hell.
Hey, are you telling me we can't use one of these things? Check it out. It's got everything. It's got four-wheel drive, 150 horsepower, a propeller. It's got a marine compass, a fish finder, an echo sounder. It's got a killer stereo system. Hey, about the only thing it doesn't do is talk.
Can we talk?
This is so funny.
Come on. They put Baywatch on Amazon.
I know, you told
me. But they remastered. They did a 30th anniversary Baywatch, all remastered with the new music composed and everything. I thought it was a riot, and I put it on as a joke, and I forgot that the show is actually ridiculously entertaining. It's got something for everybody.
Yeah. Yes, it does.
No, I didn't mean like that. I mean, like, there's life-saving that they take really seriously, and then there's slow-motion beach running that is all tongue-in-cheek, and this, everything that you saw. What, doesn't have a talking car? Come on, that's a riot. Yeah, Knight Rider,
no,
of
that's
course.
Super funny. I just thought it was hysterical. It's
Grand
hilarious.
And Baywatch.
And all I could think of in my head was that Friends episode when they're like, I think it's the one where Joey moves out and they call him and Chandler call each other and they watch the opening of Baywatch and it's Yasmeen Bleeth.
Oh, they're running in slow motion. Sure. That's so funny.
That just made me so happy.
All right, Mrs. Ryan, let us check in with the East Coast feed.
Yeah.
We'll keep a nice Connecticut theme here.
All right.
Between myself and the Telefunken crew and our Danbury Chivers. So let's go over here, and I don't know where to start. There are like six of them. I'm not going to play them all today. There are five of them, actually. But I do want to – let's start in here because I have something to say about it. I think it's ridiculous. Let's play it. Right. Roll it.
Ryan, East Coast Feed, part one, snowstorm awaiting the Northeast. Hey, Brooke's here.
Hi.
So Brooke's already so she'll be like officially moved in March. So that's the thing. I just got yelled at by my cousin Noelle for not telling her about how serious we are, because obviously we are, and as you see, and the world actually sees on YouTube. What am I talking about? Anyway, the point of this whole story here, Mr. Ryan, is behind Brooke you will see your papa's on chair.
Okay.
Yes, it's a different cover than what you have, but still your chair. Go ahead.
Either you're going to get a really big package in 2 weeks because I'm going to ship it back to you, or we're going to make another East Coast feed about me throwing it in the dumpster.
See, because she has something she wants to put there, and I said, well, one of the papas on his left. So that was it. So I want to make sure if you wanted it back, totally cool. I would ship it. If you don't, not a problem. No big deal. But we love you, Mr. and Mrs. Ryan. East Coast feed, part one of the snowstorm awaiting.
Oh, yeah. Bye.
Bye, guys.
I mean, come on. All right. First of all, I love them. I love them both. I love them both. Yeah. Brooke, I don't know you, but I love you.
Yeah.
No, I don't want that horrible chair. All right. There's a few things with it. By the way, I'm not judging anybody who likes those chairs. That's actually a really good, expensive one. It actually articulates and stuff. It's not the one from Pier 1. But it's still a Papa's on chair. Speaking of friends from the 90s, here's the history on that thing. I told him when I... He's had it since I moved to Los Angeles in 1999. Okay. Let's start there. I told him back then I didn't want it back. It wasn't mine to begin with. It was Phyllis's boyfriend's that, you know, when they broke up, she got it, and then blah, 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 and then eventually I got it when I moved out or something like that. You know what I mean? Like, there is no stinking connection to that thing.
Throw
it away.
Burn it.
Give it to, I mean, donate it would be the ideal thing if anybody would want it, but it's so big and heavy. I can't even imagine. Like, it doesn't come apart like the Pier 1s do because it's a big articulating base. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, we had a
Throw
Pier 1.
Away, guys.
We had a Pier 1 at my house, and I sat in it a lot. And, get rid of it. We don't need that shit.
All right. but check it in. They were getting ready for the snowstorm, I think they said. So let's check in with the second part there. Roll it, Hal.
Mr. and Mrs. Ryan, part two of the snow-filled Danbury. As you can see outside, there's not much going on. It's a little bit of dusting, and, like, nothing's really happening. Brooke's falling asleep. There she is right there. Mike's over there.
Say hi,
Aldina.
What up?
Hi, Aldina.
We're just hanging out watching animated movies because what else is there to do? We ordered Domino's. That's the real exciting thing happening on the East Coast when it's not snowing. Well, except for what? Like a dusting. It's like shit. Anyway, and then things like that, and then she's gone. There we go. Love you guys.
Bye.
Give me a better update if we get real snow. Bye.
Did you say update you if we get real snow? Didn't they get pummeled?
Yeah. Niagara Falls froze.
That's what I heard.
It's not warm there. There's
yeah, no, you
snow.
Can't drive in Connecticut. I heard it was awful. It was no. Blizzard-like conditions.
That's what I read.
All the Telefunken guys are nodding as well. But you guys got out of town, no problem. Okay. When did you leave?
Yesterday.
So this was before the storm? This was...
Before the storm, yeah. It's 20 below zero right now.
Holy smokes. Okay, no guys, thanks. He just said it was 20 below zero right now in Connecticut.
No, thank
Good
you.
Good grief.
That's crazy.
That's crazy.
I'm from upstate New York. Like, we had lake effect snow and ice storms and shit, but, like, that sounds awful.
Yeah, it does. One more East Coast feed. This is a quick one. Mrs. Ryan Jeez. From, I believe, last night. Roll it, hell.
This is Ryan. This is Brooke and I, East Coast feed, live from Harlem. We're at the Red Rooster here in Harlem. We're feeling some good music. We got some people dancing with us. Because they're feeling the music as well. Brooke is exposed to Manhattan on a random Monday night. What's love got to do with it? We got a little Tina Turner playing. One thing to love, East Coast feed from NYC. Even better music is coming on, just letting you know. And Nicole, I was serious. It's happening. Tuesday next month.
What?
Where were they?
I don't know, but the end was, Nicole, it's happening. He was talking to you, and then he said something about next month? What?
Oh.
Are you guys planning something?
Zero
do you know something
idea.
That I don't know?
Brooke and I are not friends on Facebook even, so I have no idea what he's talking about.
So we really don't know what he's talking about?
Zero.
Oh, okay. I thought for sure you guys had something worked out, because he was trying to visit, and we were, you know, there's a lot of stuff going on.
I know.
All right. I'll have to trust you on that one.
Excited to hear what maybe is happening.
I know. Well, Mrs. Ryan, it's time to ask the question then that is on everyone's mind.
Da, 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 da. Da, da, da.
What's going on, Mrs. Ryan?
Okay, this is super cool to me. I hope it's super cool to everyone. I think... The article I'm going to talk about is really small, but there's like lots of ways you can expand on it. So,
okay. Sounds interesting.
New research is exploring the role that memory is playing with our food consumption and choices.
Oh, I love this.
Yes. Older research really focused on the limbic system, like the hippocampus and the hormones and like how your body's
made. How do you make a hormone? Hey-o!
That the old research really focused on that, like what physiologically triggers you to want a certain kind of food and, you know, blah, blah, blah. This newer research that they're starting to explore is with the frontal and prefrontal cortex,
that's not the lobe.
It's in front. The limbic system, I didn't make this up. I'll talk about it later. But like, this is the limbic system, which is the old stuff. This is the brain stem. This is the first part of the brain. And the frontal cortex goes over it.
We all need to know what you're doing first. So you're going to make a brain and a brain stem with your fist here?
Brain stem is here.
But now that you're doing that, and we know that that's what you're doing.
Yeah.
Is that, okay, great. Now let's give us the map.
Brain stem.
Okay.
Limbic system is your thumb. Okay. And that's the old stuff, like the hormones and all that.
Would there technically be two of these together, or is it just the one?
I think there's technically two, but it cuts at your knuckle, basically, and they're together. And then the frontal cortex is what is the newest part of the brain that ties it all together. So when you get stressed out or you have like cortisol or something, this part goes up, so it disconnects.
Really?
So,
almost fight or flight, like your brain goes into... Interesting.
That's where this... It lives in here. So when this part's not connected, this has full reign. The old part of your body and system that's like triggered by hormones and shit.
Okay.
Runs the roost. But now they're researching how this part integrates with like stimuli and like what you intake and like what your memory is, and so like what you see on TV, who you're talking to, what you're doing, what those habits are, like what the context and setting is for when you eat things plays a role, not just like what does your body crave to survive.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's so neat. So I'll do more looking into that, but awesome. I love that they're talking about it.
I like that you're talking about it. Thanks. Letting us know.
going back, though, what, like, a little bit to where this all kind of starts, though, like studying the old part of the brain, this part, what they're finding in lizards is that trauma and brain response is genetically imprinted. So this part of the brain is, like, passed down. And so it's finding that...
I agree with that.
Yeah.
Because I agree, I believe that we inherit our trauma from other people. You know what I mean? They've lived their lives and formed their personalities based on the trauma that they've experienced.
Yes.
It's part of the ingredients that makes their soup. So this makes perfect sense to me.
It's part of what makes the soup. But the thing that I found so fascinating about this is, like, expand out, take the from the first study and, like, go farther with the lizard brains of, like, that gets passed on. But now we have the frontal cortex to, like, integrate thought with hormones and, like, in your body, whatever. And they're finding that not only can the trauma be passed down, but it's more so the response that your body builds up to trauma, which is the immune system foundation.
Reactionary measures.
Right. But if you, like, what I took from this is, like, basically if you're present with whatever trauma is going on and you, like, absorb it or digest it or whatever and get rid of the nonsense, you're saving future generations that trauma.
What you're saying, Mrs. Ryan, is spend some time up here, work your shit out, and make the next generation healthier.
Yes.
Yes. And you, in this generation, will be much, much happier. That's
you'll
a personal
be happier.
Guarantee.
And one of the things I'm going to make real is social genetics, because I think that plays a role, like how you are with other people. Sure. So not just like what you pass down, but like what you bring into the circumstances.
These are all ingredients in the soup. I agree.
Yeah. So... heads up on that. This might be going on, and this might have been going on for a while, but this is the first I read about, like, a foray of human and robotic boundaries and interactions.
Ooh, okay.
The Amazon warehouse workers.
Oh, man.
Did you read
it? Yeah, it's terrible. It's just Wally to me. You got to wear a special belt if you work at Amazon so that you don't get run over by robots.
Yeah, because they're changing literally the whole setup of the warehouses, because they used to have it so that, like, sensors were built into certain squares where, like, humans worked and, like, robots would go around it.
Exactly.
And now they're like, well, humans might have to fix robots and, like, they might need to, like, cut through areas. So humans should wear these belts that have sensors in them.
It's the equivalent of a hard hat in a falling something area. This is like, you got to wear this. You basically have to wear a transmitter so that a robot thinks, oh, there's another robot, or there's a robot looking human over there.
And they can see them sooner and recalculate their route. That's nuts.
Well, generally speaking, robots weigh more than we do too. You know what I mean? So everything does take more time to maneuver.
I didn't think about that. I just think it's a little nuts. It's probably the way of the future, but it sounds nuts to think that they're building and constructing warehouses based on robots versus humans. Like,
yeah.
Just wear the vest. And then lastly, to keep the Connecticut theme alive.
Oh, I love it.
I did
Let's
not
hear it.
Even know. But Melissa Etheridge is helping make Mystic Pizza a musical.
No kidding.
Yes.
How about that?
A 1988 movie that I didn't know about until you... is set in Connecticut.
You didn't know about that movie?
I think I'd heard of it, but I hadn't seen it.
Do I only know about it because I grew up there? There's so much stuff like that.
No, it's 1988. I think I just was on a weird age cusp where, like,
oh, I see.
I missed it.
But I mean, it's not that great a movie to begin with, but if you were of whatever the age those girls were at the time,
it's a great coming of age
story. Exactly. Then if it hit you at that time, I think it's very relatable.
Totally. And I love that, like, they're bringing it to Broadway so they can expand the base of stories that we know from the classics and stuff.
We've been there. It's great pizza.
Great. It's where I learned about spaghetti and pizza together. Love it.
Is that true?
I think I did it by myself.
I believe, but it was the same trip.
But, like, they had it on a special. It was Thursday, and, like, that was a thing.
I do remember that. Yeah. Spaghetti pizza. You're right.
Yeah.
That's so funny.
Super neat.
It
I love it.
It was the same trip, and then you went and replicated it down in Rome,
yes,
Beach.
That's exactly. So,
is that it?
That's it.
Mrs. Ryan, that was awesome. That's been What's Going On? From Rockefeller Center in New York. My goodness. All right, Mrs. Ryan.
Yeah.
It's time to, we've all been waiting for this. We've been trying to get this guy in here for months. He has allowed us to broadcast in the way that we have been lately, thanks to all of this beautiful Telefunken gear. In a few minutes after this break, Tony Fishman from Telefunken microphones, Motorsports. We're going to talk about the whole bit. Tony from Telefunken will be here. More to come right after this.
Can't wait.
I love the colorful clothes she wears and the way the sunlight plays upon her hair. I hear the sound of a gentle mood on the wind that lifts her perfume through the air. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations. Picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations. Close my eyes. She's somehow closer now. Softly smile, I know she must be kind. When I look in her eyes, she goes with me to a blossom room.
I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations. Ooh, I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me excitations. Picking up good vibrations.
That's it. We're here with Tony from Telefunken.
Awesome.
What's finally happening, man? Tony Fishman is here, everybody.
Yay!
So good to be out here and escape that that freeze going on back east.
Yeah? You said, well, you said 20 below?
You were like, escaped, right? Yeah, probably with the wind chill or something.
So I think cold.
The moment I got on the plane, I got a photo. It was like 2 degrees. My wife and child are snowed in.
Oh, I bet, right?
Iced in.
So what's it like? I mean, what's it been? You guys got out just before the storm, right?
Yeah.
But this storm is all over the news, even out here, so it's a big deal.
Yeah, we only had one storm in November, and this year has been, like, really mild for snow. So the second storm of the season, sort of, and really affected the whole Northeast again.
Ugh. Taking it down. All right, well, you're here. You're here for NAMM. We should probably start with that, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
Officially speaking, that's why you're here.
Yeah.
Just as a sidebar, can you tell me what NAMM is?
NAMM is the National Association of Musicians Merchants.
Oh.
That's what the what it stands for. They gather in Anaheim each year. in January, and it's all sort of industry manufacturing of professional audio.
Is it at a convention center or something?
Yeah, at the convention center.
Anaheim Convention, right?
Everyone has a booth and kind of shows their new products and talks to resellers and different distributors. And it's a really great place to network and meet sort of the people behind the gear.
I would equate it to Comic-Con for
audio
reproduction, mm-hmm. you know, this type of gear. It's just as stinking big. And it's I used to go when I was a kid with FVP Productions. My child, absolutely. I used to go to CES and NAMM. But NAMM used to be in a different place. Did it used to be Vegas?
Well, there used to be they do the AES, and AES used to move back and forth usually between New York and San Francisco.
Maybe that's what I'm thinking of. The Javits Center.
NAMM has sort of always been Anaheim.
Okay.
However, now I think AES is partially rolled into NAMM, but it's getting bigger, and we hope to have a lot of traffic through there. And
I saw pictures of that. Couldn't have been your booth. Maybe it was a booth from the past, but it looked big, and you had the big Telefunken logo hanging from the ceiling and everything.
Yeah, last year, we went big.
Nice.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. I mean, it looked like you could see that from everywhere in the place. So
yeah,
that
was the first time we had a cloud or a hanging. Logo over the booth. It was pretty well received.
Being that that's what you're actually here for, we're going to talk about so much stuff, and I've got a list here, so we won't miss anything, and I don't care about time, so when you have to go is when we have to stop, or when we're done. But I do want to cover NAMM. Exactly what are you launching anything at NAMM this year? What is your presence?
Yeah, this year we have some new products. We're going to be launching an Alchemy series. In the past, we had something called RFT, which was sort of our affordable home studio, project studio microphones.
Is that like the stuff that we're using here, or is this that stuff?
We're using Dynamics, which are more for broadcast and stage. But the project studio realm, where a lot of people want the sound of our Diamond series microphones, but we have to try to
affordability from that standpoint. I understand.
We use all the same ingredients in a way, and a lot of the same transformers and tubes, and have hand assembled, and we build everything in Connecticut by hand. And basically, there are three production teams now doing the Diamond series range, which are the more expensive, historically accurate. Microphones, and then the RFT is sort of we did this. The whole Telefunken trademark story is involved. How I was able to acquire the trademark.
I'm hoping you'll tell that here today. I don't know if you want to tell it right now, or we'll get into it. But this is your show. We are so excited that you're here.
It's really a miracle, and really enjoy doing what we do. We have a great team back in Connecticut putting the products together. In a little over 15 years, we went from, three or four key individuals to a company of 30.
Wow.
So
that's
operating
crazy growth.
30,000 square feet.
I was going to say, you just
expanded,
increased.
Yeah, yeah. So this,
but that was a big deal, right?
Yeah, yeah. It's been a big deal, and it's allowing
so modest.
It's allowing us to be, do some things. We're trying to make some of those. The RFT is sort of going to become this Alchemy series, and they're going to get made a little lighter, so they're a little easier to ship. They can be built a little easier, we'll hopefully be able to pass the savings on to our customers that want to have a Telefunken microphone in their studio, but can't afford essentially one of our top of the line.
So it'll make it a little bit more accessible to people.
Yeah, I mean, they all have that Telefunken, that warm, sound, and it's interesting to see. We're opening up sort of the middle of the range, if you will, and
that's fantastic.
In the future, we'll be able to build a lot more microphones that are sort of in between that project studio range and our top of the line. We have incredible amount of room for growth there.
Sounds fantastic. Are you excited?
Yeah, I really am.
Okay, good. Okay, good. Don't hide it.
All starting to
It's
click,
a really
you know?
Neat space to yeah. dive into and to be part of, like, your side of things and ours and whatever.
I agree.
But, like, it's super neat that you can, that you have the capability to expand in the middle like that.
Yeah, my family has been a big part of that. And the building, you know, is something that's been, it's a family-owned property. So
we should start. You're born and raised in Connecticut also, right? Like
yep.
me.
Yep.
And were you from South Windsor? Were you?
I was born in Hartford. I grew up in West Hartford.
Okay.
I soon moved to Simsbury. I lived in Simsbury for a little while and then moved to Farmington. And I've been in Farmington for about 10 years. Farmington is
a barometer.
Farmington Valley is just near about 9 miles outside Hartford city limits, the beginning of the suburbs there.
Oh, okay.
South, though, right?
It is north.
It is?
Northwest of Hartford.
There you go.
Oh, okay.
See, I
cool.
lived
northwest of Hartford.
I've driven through it, but who the heck can remember? Up the 91?
Well, Telefunken is located off the 291 corridor, which. Is kind of more of an industrial area, sort of the other side of town.
Cool.
And a lot of great manufacturing around there.
Other than you guys?
Well, you know, we do what we do by using a lot of New England manufacturing, a lot of CNC shops and
cool.
injection mold houses and places to get, you know, spring and tiny metal parts made.
So it's, you're not just assembled in Connecticut. You truly, your parts and everything
no,
else,
the
that your products are made in Connecticut.
We really haven't cut any corners. We really
That's important
do things the
say,
way they need to be done. And, you know, especially with the Diamond Series microphones, I've really hunted down the right people to be making each individual part.
Wow.
It took quite a while. I mean, that's really the miracle of Telefunken, is it kind of all grew out of a broken switch of all things.
Well, so we should maybe start there and then to why you went down that road to resurrect this company.
Absolutely.
All right, so let's hear it. What's the broken switch and how'd you fix it?
You know, for years I traveled around and was doing stuff in music, and along the way I kind of started collecting microphones, and sort of the story goes is that along the way I able to acquire a couple original Telefunken 251 microphones.
What were you doing?
Good question. At the time building a home recording studio, but I was in Nashville and I learned about Warner Brothers Reprise Records at the time.
Yeah.
Going out of business, and a friend of mine was like, well, you should maybe put in a bid for their microphones. And
oh, wow.
I bought on a whim, I bought a huge microphone collection, and the realization when I received, it was about 300 microphones.
From Nashville?
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
awesome.
And I'm sure varied conditions.
In varied conditions, and some of them needed to be restored. And some.
It's
of them
a storied history
needed,
in Nashville
needed,
with
needed
music.
Love,
and
that was sort of the mother of invention, if you will, in that. I got a crash course in vintage microphones, and
I hear what you're saying. Though the story behind who recorded on all those microphones mm-hmm. over the years is probably unbelievable.
You know,
yeah.
I was kind of pushing the limits if I could, and I went out, and when parts weren't available, I went out and recreated the part so I could restore the microphone. Most people
awesome.
Would rob from Peter to pay Paul or find a,
that's
another
what eBay's
microphone
for, you
to,
betcha. Yeah.
You know, and there was a huge, for a long time, I had a business called Vintage Tones, which was solely microphone focused. And
Are you Vintage Tone? Apostrophe, yes.
Yeah. So, you know, we for many years were selling other companies' microphones, and along the way, I found these Telefunkens and learned that they suffered the same Achilles heel, in that the heat from the vacuum tube inside the microphone would vulcanize the plastic, and eventually the pattern selector switch, you know, just under the head grill would fail. And I kept going and meeting people who had microphones, and we were always kind of comparing 251s, their sound. And everyone had the same problem. So I said, wow. I'm going to make the switch again. And it was really, I really just wanted in the beginning to make just the switch. And as soon as I got...
Was that for you so that you could have a sense of accomplishment? What was your reasoning to even do that? Or just, there's a problem, I need to solve it.
It was a problem I needed to solve. The microphones were worth so much, they deserve being repaired.
That makes sense.
You know, a vintage original is, you know, $15,000 or $20,000.
Oh.
It's the real top end of a vintage microphone market.
That's what Tommy King, I don't know if you know him, he was here a couple days ago, he used to play for Maroon 5 and stuff. He's into different bands now, but he has some vintage
Telefunkens.
These are the type of things that he was talking about that we were like just sort of dancing around, like it was no big deal.
I had no idea.
The vintage stuff is unbelievable.
So from this switch and the relationship with the Plastics House in Marlboro, Connecticut, who helped me recreate all of those parts, we started making 251 parts again. And I went actually to, I don't know if it was an AES or, I think it was AES, not NAMM, the first year. It was about 2000. And I had these switch parts and I kind of showed them to a few key individuals and they were like, oh my God, you have these parts. We can finally fix these microphones. And
it's like, imagine having how many cars you could put back on the road, theoretically, if all of a sudden that one part got
made. Like magic, what you did.
It brought me to LA. In 04, I came to LA for about a year. I was living here and through a relationship with Alan Sides and Ocean Way Studio. And another long story about Joni Mitchell and a fire that had happened with one of Alan's microphones. There was actually a fire damaged 251 that I was able to restore for Alan.
That was damaged by Joni Mitchell?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty cool, man.
Gave him back part of his life.
That's pretty cool.
Like,
I mean,
you're just such a...
So all this stuff started happening. And the way this happened was, as I started into these couple little projects, restoring the Alan Sides microphone, and then was contacted by a friend of mine who was like, well, wouldn't you like to do this as Telefunken? And I was like, well, how is that?
How could that possibly be possible?
How is that going to be possible? So... through the relationship with a guy named Oliver, I learned of how the original company had been out of business for quite some time and that they hadn't renewed or ever really registered the diamond-shaped logo in the U.S. So Oliver registered...
Which is, for those looking at the screen right now, is right... Well, it's on your shirt, I guess, as well, but right down there.
Oliver registered the mark and sold me the diamond shape without the word Telefunken. So I had the logo without the word Telefunken. And
so it had the square and the lightning bolts, everything, just no word.
Correct.
Okay.
And I began making actual replica recreations of those microphones again. And then I, you know, had an attorney basically tell me, well, put the word Telefunken back in the box and start selling
baby
microphones
steps.
And
baby steps,
creating use and commerce again for the first time.
Get so established.
Early in 2001, we started selling the 251 again.
That's so cool.
And it's just been an amazing series of events since then, and progressively building better microphones and really reaching a lot of artists, and the connections with the music is a miracle within a miracle, in that we get to really supply microphones to bands we really love what they do.
You were excited about two folks who sat in those two chairs a long time ago. We were talking about just before we started, Jerry Garcia, Bob Weir. Not bad. That stuff means something to you. That stuff means something to me too. We feel it. Other people can't see it. It's not tangible.
Yeah.
But it's energy, it's vibrations. There's something going on there.
Yeah, they levitated him in this chair.
That
was
that true?
The parlor trick.
Is that right?
Do you know about this?
No.
Letterman was like, "We're going to do a parlor trick tonight, and Bob, don't you know some power parlor tricks?" And Bob's like, yeah, and there's a whole clip on it.
Holy cow.
They lift Garcia up, I guess four guys in the studio, like grab him and lift him up just with like two fingers, and then they like, it was pretty heavy and awkward, and then they like do something over his head, and they lift him again, and he goes like right up.
And it's Jerry they floated?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, that's amazing.
Out of the chair.
It's got to be a great
so
clip.
I mean, obviously, you know, so, magic. So
the reason why, that's connects to me is that, you know, when I said I was traveling, a lot of my travels were with music. you know, following bands like the Grateful Dead and Max Creek and Fish.
You followed the Dead?
Yeah.
I know a bunch of people that did. Yeah. It's so, I love meeting people
about,
that did.
About 1985 to 1995, during that period, I was, you know, kind of going and seeing shows and traveling around and recording and taping a lot of a lot of dead shows.
Did you have the big stick and the whole thing?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
You remember when we went and saw the Hollywood Bowl?
John Mayer.
What's it called now? Dead & Company.
Yeah.
We went and saw them, and all those people with the big sticks.
Yeah.
They kept getting asked to take them down. Yeah. That's what they were doing.
But you were like the OG.
Well,
there used to be tape recorders at the end of those sticks, right?
I got started late, but I was nicknamed. I always had this big thing about gear and like bringing the best microphones I could bring and
vintage tone, of course.
I bet.
So it's like a whole East Coast West Coast continuum of like. Competition within the tapers, and I got nicknamed the Armada.
The Armada, yeah. Because of the amount of equipment you would bring?
Yeah, the less is more thing was something I didn't learn early on.
I don't know what you mean at all. You know, you can do a podcast with an iPhone, right? So I relate. Go ahead.
It's amazing how we all connect. And, you know, through that scene, as Telefunken began, we got involved with a music festival that was in Bridgeport, Connecticut, Gathering the Vibes.
Really?
No kidding.
Years after 95.
Gathering the Vibes. Come on, man.
Where did they used to do it?
They used to do it at Seaside Park.
By the Polka Dot Playhouse.
Yeah.
They rebuilt that bridge? When I was a kid, there was an arson fire, and they burned the bridge down.
Yeah, there was P.T. Barnum's big site down there. And so... You know, that festival kind of was something where we developed our dynamic microphone sort of on the stages of being in the festival, you know, crowd, and really bringing each year kind of a different flavor and finding out what people really liked and refining them along over a few period of years. And the dynamic stuff has been doing I shouldn't call it stuff, but it's beautiful stuff.
We're very happy.
Still stuff.
With the dynamic stuff.
And it's a great product. And I think it's amazing that so much has grown out of what was a music scene that I still love going and recording music and being part of that scene. And, you know, that's where the connection is between the artists and the audience,
mm-hmm.
and the technology to deliver, you know, and
you're bridging gaps again. You're, you know what I mean, between the artist and the audience.
And it makes a big deal. And like I knew or a difference. And like I knew a little bit about the sound quality of stuff, but like you take it to a whole new level. And like just the way you do with talk shows and like you take it to another level. Like it's really incredible what you give people.
I've been known to kind of jump down the rabbit hole, and with Telefunken very much so like that. It is something I love wholeheartedly, and you know,
that's clear. It's your passion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is a passion. This is not a job. I had an idea to get rich quick. It's not. This is you. You believe this stuff, right?
I found it, or it found me, and I believe that. You know, I'm here for a reason to, you know, spread good vibrations and make sure
that... That's on the card here, good vibrations. I want to talk about that.
That, you know, we kind of do special things with our microphones.
What does that mean to you?
To me, it is really special from the music end of it, from the power of broadcast to be able to create awareness. There are a lot of reasons in the world today where people need to, you know, pull together, and it's the symbol of the microphone and the hearts and minds, right, of what we can do with these things to change the world.
What does Telefunken stand for?
Telefunken, the word tele is to transmit, and funken is spark. And it was put together in a way to make work with sparks. To transmit at a distance, and that's something that has been really the underlying connection. You know, I feel very much like it's a grounding rod in a sense.
Mm, I love it.
It attracts a tremendous amount of good vibration, and it's an honor to be able to kind of bring those products back and to see whole new generations of people creating music with them.
Do you find that you, TONI FISHMAN, also attract good vibrations?
I'd like to think so.
I find that I, Jay Ryan, do. And I was not always this way, but I certainly do these days. And it's a gift. I had a bunch of stuff that I had to do this morning that I didn't expect to have to do. I thought I'd be able to nice and relax and prepare the show. You saw I was getting new tires and all sorts of stuff. Went down to a flat tire this morning. What are you going to do? I had a number of different opportunities to meet strangers that I would have never had a reason or an opportunity to interact with. And it's very interesting to me. I don't know how to say this, but the level of people that are comfortable talking to me are very happy people. And I don't mean that like they're crazy or whatever. I just mean people who aren't having the greatest day aren't looking at me. I'm invisible to them. But people who are like me and who are having a great day also, man, we are attracted to each other like magnets. And I was wondering if you maybe get that a little bit too.
I do. I tend to get in situations where things collide.
Okay, that's kind of what I'm talking about.
You know, and I don't know really when the first time I saw the photo of that 550 spider. But it kind of made a lasting impression. And
we're talking about the...
To find out that there was a connection in the past between Telefunken and Porsche.
There we go. Yep.
So, growing up as a kid, about the time I was a teen, you know, my grandfather, we joked. My brother had gotten a car from my grandfather. And my brother, I think, ended up with like an Opel Manta in 72 or something. Because he wanted a German car, but it needed to be an expensive German
car. But at a time when it wasn't, yeah cool.
Well, I thought it was cool. It had a lightning bolt on the front of it. It was bright orange. And, you know, I was a little kid, and, you know, my brother's 10 years older. And, you know, so I said to my grandfather, I said, you know, one day, you know, is there any way I could, you know, maybe get a Porsche? And he said, well, you'll be lucky if you ever get a Volkswagen, you know? So... It started, like
that West Hartford mentality.
It started me on a pursuit of Volkswagen, and which led into, after kind of getting Telefunken off the ground, it led into a love affair with Porsche.
Why did it make you go towards Volkswagen? Was it because he said you'd be lucky to get a Volkswagen, so you thought, oh, that might be attainable, I should start there?
There's that, and you know, chutzpah, if you will. You know, I wanted to, wanted to be successful, I wanted to...
But you said Porsche first, and now you're going to Volkswagen.
Well, no.
Did you have the connection already in your mind? Because they're so similar. I just
think
am curious.
The two things are connected in the way that I associate with them is, you know, I look at those earliest pictures of the bent window pre-A cars, you know,
beautiful.
With the Telefunken radio in the dash. And, yeah, there's nothing more that...
You said it to me too. I've no more words.
I could stand there and just look at that and drive it, or you know, a lot of those radios don't work all that well. And for what the cars are worth, well, I mean, back in the day they worked great, they sounded fantastic, but there are very few people who can actually fix those radios today, or who have the tubes to do that. And it opened sort of Pandora's box for me in that I really like the idea of, you know, a German car radio company, a German car company creating such beautiful machinery, you know, that the gear needs to survive. So pretty much as soon as I had
this
any,
is the switch for the microphone. Any, he's got to do any, the radio for the Porsche. You any, see it too, right?
I see it yeah. all. It's so cool to see how the parallels
so
converge.
I eventually got to really be interested in Porsche. You know, as a kid, there were in my neighborhood, there were a couple fathers who had cars nearby in the garage. I was a very, you know, aware of these cars. And
nosy is what we call it.
Yeah, it's
No, you were. You mean they were on your radar, right?
They were on my radar.
Oh, okay.
And a close friend of mine growing up, a neighbor of mine who mowed an awful lot of lawn, ended up buying a 924 and then eventually a 944. And there was another neighbor of mine that had a 914.6.
Whoa.
And I think my dentist at the time had a 911. And, you know, like growing up as a kid, I saw those cars and, you know, I'm going to have one as an adult. And it's just weird to find something that I love so much in the Telefunken brand connect to both music, the radios, and the cars.
It doesn't make sense, right? There's no other way to tie all your interests
such
together.
Such a rich, rich history. Find out that that car and that sponsorship won a Pan American race. One of the first, I think that car was the first livery. I think it was the first official Porsche before that sponsorship hadn't.
That hand-painted one, you know, with the Fletcher Aviation Telefunken.
I'm getting like fever waves.
55. I think it was a number 55. And it was, of course, a 55.
54.
Oh, it was. Okay.
It was a 54 Speedster. But that the one time I was blessed to visit the factory in Stuttgart, I walked into the museum and I come up the front stairs and there it is. And I remember seeing it and just like...
Is that the actual car?
Yeah.
That's at the museum, so it is,
yeah.
Right? Oh,
it's
my
god! Right
gosh.
There. It's front and center.
That is the coolest.
It's front and center. And there's so
but
much...
Is that a religious experience for you? That would be...
Yeah.
You know, the...
Yeah, I mean, that's it. That's, you know...
At the mothership, no less.
I mean, there, there are other parts of those cars, you know, the cabriolets, the coupes, all that early 356 stuff. I find all those lines related in things like, you know, the bus and the Beetle. The first car I ever restored was a VW bus, and it is the company's, the Telefunken bus. That was my first
that one?
Dabble in
black and white
motorsports.
Or cream
black,
and white. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, I found it in Jerome,
stunning.
Arizona, and restored that, and been working kind of. With the cars ever since in the background, in that when I was in a state not knowing how to make the right decision, I would go work on the car and clear my mind and come back. And usually when I got done doing whatever I got done doing, I figured the other thing out.
Isn't it weird how one focus can get you back to the other one?
Back and forth.
It's opposite of what you would think it would be.
Yeah. My mother and father hate it. They want me to just focus, you know, focus on those microphones, Tony.
Oh, really?
Yeah, well, yeah.
It's easier to say, what's he doing? He's doing this one thing.
But it's not. It's not just one thing. It's realizing that really anything's possible with the right focus and the right team and the right relationships.
Yes.
You know, I've been really lucky to have a couple project cars that have turned into something. My latest and greatest venture was to try to figure out how to make a vintage 911.
Are we getting right into it? This is the feast of the resistance here. I mean, my goodness. All right, so before we actually get to that, you've done a few gas burning 911. I don't want to call them resto mods, but they're, what would you, how would you?
I've done everything from preservation class car that I want to keep as original as possible to full-on restoration. You know, my first real significant car was building a 73 2.8 liter RSR. I used a company called Automobile Associates in Canton, Connecticut. They're
okay.
Dear friends of mine. And, you know, I got through that project. It was a 7-year project to build the car, and it taught me really everything about RSRs and the racing side of the 911, STs, which I really like that.
Me too.
Growing of the ducktail and the whale tail and everything that followed. You know, those cars are precious to me.
Well, you have a bunch of 911s too, don't you?
Yeah,
Do you want to? Can we? Let's get on the list of at least a couple of
them. Let's just
jump
in, so I have some context.
People here are going to want to know.
This is where it turns into the Porsche AA meeting, right?
This is what our people want to see. So,
I do own a bunch of cars. Some of those cars are there's a '68 912 rally car.
Jeez.
That was owned by a guy named Albin Greberg, who raced in Sweden. with that car, and they chased it down after a few years. Got very lucky to find it, and there are a few that are our car, that car and the RSR, I think are cars I probably always keep if I can afford to. And, I have a 58 356 A Cabriolet in ivory, which is sort of the oldest car I have. I've always wanted to end up with a car with a Telefunken radio in it.
So you got to get back to the A's, right?
Eventually.
Yeah.
I'm late to the game, though, because I've been distracting myself with, you know, some of these other projects. But I've always had a couple of track cars, a 78 SC 3-liter, some smart racing suspension stuff on it. Real great fun at Lime Rock.
I was going to say, you go to Lime Rock,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I've been driving there with Lime Rock, the club at Lime Rock for...
Are you part of the club?
10 years.
Driver's club?
There, yeah. And before that, I did a lot with Connecticut Valley Region, Porsche Club.
And shout out to Zone 1.
Their DE program.
Shout out to Zone 1, PCA.
Sort of taught me how to drive and what a 911 could do at the track. I cannot believe the amount of the beating that these cars take.
Yeah.
So did you really learn to hurt on a 911 at Lime Rock?
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's amazing. So diving into the left and just
seeing
what happens.
It's a really beautiful track, a great facility. Skip's done a tremendous job at making us all feel really welcome there and taking care of the track.
When I was a kid, I went to the Skip Barber Racing School there, but it was neons and I want to get this right. Definitely stealths, maybe Avengers, but definitely Dodge stealths and then Vipers. And I don't think I even got up to the Viper, but I think it was like, you know what I mean? We think of Porsches and Vets and all these other things. Neons.
On but that track, Lime Rock. That's the one on yellow car, yeah?
Exactly.
So like, you know, I threw CVR and... you know, got involved with some of the car shows there, and really great community in New England. You know, there's guys like Wayne Carini.
Yeah, at 40.
You know, and my dear friend Dean Cassano from Motor Cars Incorporated in Plainville, Connecticut.
Okay.
Dean introduced me to the Dream Ride.
So we're talking about, all right.
In Farmington, Connecticut.
This is August 23rd through the 25th, dreamride.org, we believe it is.
Yes, dreamride.org. This is probably the most fun I've ever had in motorsports and socially philanthropic.
Is it an annual event?
This is an annual event that is raised $2 million last year for the Special Olympics.
Amazing.
Oh, my goodness.
The best of the best show up with their cars, and they do a cruise where they take athletes out in the cars for a short drive. And there's a big Harley rally, I think, that drives up from Florida.
Wow.
It's
a big to-do.
It's just amazing.
And you're, what is your involvement with that?
Well, I'm...
Other than being their biggest secret weapon, which I believe is what we said.
I'm really great friends with Dean, and I really owe it to him in that he kind of maybe sees my eye and what I've been capable of doing and asked me to kind of come and get involved. And I've been bringing cars and showing cars there and being a part of the community there and helping out. We sponsored a polo match recently.
A polo match?
Yeah.
The horse one, yeah?
Yeah.
All right.
So how does that connect?
Well, the polo grounds right there, they have a equestrian stable and do a great job at introducing people to polo. And, you know, it's a passion of Michael Bizzuto, who...
Now I see.
Is
So does he have his own, I don't know, would you call it a ring? What do you call it, a field?
Yeah, there's a polo field there and equestrian stable. And
beautiful.
A really beautiful facility for the Dream Ride. And it is just such an amazing thing to see.
Where is it? Where's it located? You may have said it, but
I
want to
mention.
In
Farmington, Connecticut, at the Farmington Polo Grounds.
Okay. Oh, so it's just that simple, Farmington Polo Grounds. Okay.
Yeah. So it's a hometown event for me. And I usually
where you raised $2 million for Special Olympics.
Yeah.
It's a fantastic thing. He's incredibly humble.
It's fantastic.
We made some Stars and Stripes microphones for Michael to bring out and you know, I think the symbol of the microphone is almost like a torch.
The baton, right? And the torch, sure, both, yeah, all
so,
the above.
So, you know, I really like the idea of getting involved with different causes. And in this new year, 2019, I'm going to try to start something called Colors for Causes. In that, have you seen any of our colored microphones? We make them in different
colors. Microphones of color, of course. Yeah. But yes, I have seen those. They're gorgeous. Ours arrived beautiful. It was only the lighting and everything that we had to sort of blacken them all out. So I think it was your eye caught that.
Yeah. But the colors, you know, I'd like to, in the future, maybe find a cause for each color.
Oh,
and then
beautiful.
Donate proceeds from the sale of that particular
that maybe
microphone
match the ribbons
to
or whatever.
Each cause. And, you know, maybe even find artists that like being behind the cause. And, you know, we've done some really fun stuff with microphones.
We should also probably say, I mean...
and personalizing them.
This little podcast is not the type of echelon talent that they normally... place their products with. Some of the bands you've told me about that actually use your products are, I mean, can you name any of them? These are people that people know.
Probably most consistently, probably one of the biggest would be, I'm going to give a shout out to my friends at Fish.
Friends at Fish, exactly.
Yeah.
I happen to love them also.
Yeah.
Yeah. No relation.
I've been to some of their shows.
You know.
Oh, that's right.
but we must be brothers or something like that. Connected.
They use
somehow.
Your stuff for their shows?
Yeah.
That's incredible. I love that.
That's,
I'm assuming from Following the Dead, though, that you've probably been into Fish for a long time also.
Yeah. Well, in the beginning, after Jerry passed, I took a little while for me to hang my hat somewhere else, so to speak. But always been there and really liked what they do. And,
sure.
And... it's just the energy is just scintillating. You
know? I totally get it.
Unbelievable times with music, and these guys are so awesome. For Halloween, they did this. They had a whole bunch of white mic. They wanted everything white for the stage, so they asked us if we could help them with
with
white microphones and white mic stands and getting everything for them.
I bet that looked so cool.
Yeah, it sounds kind of neat. I don't know what the goal was, but
yeah,
it sounds like bones or something.
I don't know if I can pronounce it. They played, I guess, they changed their name for a moment as the translation in Swedish for Swedish Fish.
Oh, that's very funny.
Oh, yeah.
That's pretty funny. But,
it's very cool. It sounds like a way cooler version of a white party.
Yeah, I mean...
but I love it.
Since... Jerry passed, you know, going to shows like that where there's a community of people who are there to, you know, kind of let their hair out and have a good time and be different and weird and have fun and
be willing to be part of the mix.
Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah.
But that's not everybody. So, all right. So Fish.
Other bands, you know, man, I could name drop, you know, ZZ
you
Top.
You don't have. Oh, really?
Is one.
Very impressive.
Green Day. you know, we've done microphones for Celine Dion.
Really?
You know, there's one of the Van Halen back in the.
I didn't mean to put you on the spot. I want other people to know that, you
lots
know.
Lots of. I could go on and on. You know, we've had a really great friend in Nashville over the years, Martina McBride, her husband John McBride. I consider him kind of like, without his help, I would have never been able to do what I did, because I had this really great collection of vintage microphones, and it ended up going back to Nashville. I mentioned
the from Nashville,
collection.
Yeah.
So those microphones ended up going to John McBride at Blackbird Studios in Nashville, and I truly believe they belong there. And I'm glad that he has them. And
you do seem to be that
he's
guy.
He sort of kind of like
you get
helped us kind of by transferring the energy out of those vintage microphones. Kind of gave he's the godfather of being able to kind of like. Go forward, what helped create and make the business what it is. If I hadn't had that that relationship, I don't think I would have been able to make the steps forward it's that
a neat
I did.
What a, and a wonderful shout out to your friend.
Yeah.
Bravo. All right, I want to talk about now your future Porsche stuff. Because this is where you're starting to get excited. You're also getting, this is all sort of happening right now, right?
Yeah. It is happening right now.
I mean, like right now.
As we speak.
As we speak.
So
what's going on? What's your latest project?
So I had this track car that I had bought to get the engine out of for another project. And it was a shell that was sitting sort of aside. And I was like, what am I going to do with this? Mm. And, you know, the whole idea of making an electric 911. So the Electro RSR.
So all of that, we just polarized the audience, right? All of a sudden, we just said 911 and electric. Yeah. So we've just lost
They're
half
not
of
supposed
them.
To go together, correct? Those concepts?
They're not, but okay. I like the whole Dr. Frankenstein right. thing of yeah. putting things that necessarily don't belong together right. together. And
find it.
So
find it.
Cross breed of sorts is happening, in that I was able to acquire a Tesla motor and wiring harness and some infrastructure from a salvaged car, and have been making a cradle and batteries.
Can you say what model Tesla it was?
I think it was a P85D.
So one of the earlier, but the, yeah, the big sedans.
Yeah, dual motor, the more expensive version of,
right.
of the Tesla, the faster of the two. It's the rear motor, 500 horsepower.
Oh.
So
well,
and the torque numbers, I can't wait to test it. Tesla's made some race cars out of the actual car just by stripping the interior out, and those cars are like 2.3 seconds 0 to 60.
Yeah.
So
really,
I think the moment
with everything in it,
yeah, it all fit together so well. There were some hurdles along the way, like there are with anything, but we really powered through them. Once I was able to figure out the drive flanges and connecting the Tesla diff to the Porsche axle,
if I may hear from your own words, from you telling me, the goal here will be to essentially eventually have an electric powertrain that someone who has an old vintage 911 could take their motor out, put it on the shelf, get this Telefunken electric kit, for lack of a better term, and forgive me if I'm put that in their car, then have all the drivability and all of the stuff that we're talking about future-proofed, and then someday still be able to, if they wanted
make
to,
it reverse
put the other one back in.
And if you know what you're doing, it's literally about an hour job.
I've actually not cut any holes whatsoever. I've used all existing mounting points. And my project also is about keeping the same and equal weight distribution as a normal 911.
That could be radical.
So everything needs to be in the same places and the same, all the weight distribution
and
everything.
That's really so neat.
We weighed everything that came out of the car.
Okay.
And we weighed everything that went in the car. Both my friend Lee and Tony have done a great job at fabbing and thinking through all of the shortcomings of kind of doing this. And I want to say it was... relatively quickly, in a four months' time, we went from concept to actually having a car on the ground.
Wow.
That's really quick.
The one thing...
So the car's on the ground now? That's what we're...
Car is basically finished. I think if that cold didn't come, I would have been able to test the car and have footage for you today.
Wow. It was saying the snowstorm was going to...
yeah.
So I think just after NAMM, if I can find an Indian summer one day, I will get that car tested before spring.
What do you consider testing? I mean, because it's already put together. We know it theoretically works.
A lot of people who have done this, and they do it with salvage parts.
Okay.
And they do it with either Tesla batteries or batteries that have come out of a Chevy Volt or, they're repurposing.
Sure.
Well, my angle was to try to come up with new battery technology and try to figure out the lightest, safest, most compact, best C-rated batteries that I could find on the planet at this time. The C rating in a battery is how quickly the electricity can come out of the battery without it overheating.
Wow.
Okay.
So you need to be able to let
discharge
very quickly. I met a friend through Lee and Tony in Texas. I'll give him a shout out.
Mm-hmm.
John Metrick from Lone Star Battery. We're talking together about possibly co-sponsoring the car. The hope is to come out with battery packs for this purpose. We're going to end up with running.
You mean your own proprietary battery pack?
Our own proprietary battery.
Oh, wow, okay.
Pack.
So that's a whole different thing.
In the end, we'd like to sell Telefunken Motorsport batteries, cradles, wiring harness, speed controller, and
a resonator for the sound you're going to come up with at some point.
That is something.
Dude, that's so cool.
Try to figure out.
Like, you're just getting into like this whole thing that's going to mushroom out. It's so cool.
The vroom box.
Vroom box.
What?
Is sort of the idea of that and figuring out how to make it sound interesting. Could also sound like a land speeder or something like that.
I was going to say, you could make it sound like anything you want, really.
I wouldn't mind, you know, making it sound like a, you know, 935 or...
Oh, man, something cool. You hear all the pumps turning on first, all the different fuel pumps and everything.
Yeah. Be the digital sample of all those classic sounds and be able to...
All the toggles and the safety switches. Well, this sounds incredibly exciting, but what's your long-term goal for this one? I know you're still figuring it out.
Goal right now is to get the car in the spring to Lime Rock to see how efficient it is. I'm hoping the car will be able to do about 60 miles in range. It's a 20-kilowatt battery pack, so it's very small and lightweight. And hopefully we'll be able to get out there and do what like a normal DE would be like with CBR.
Yeah.
You know, so it's usually like 20 minutes to a half hour on track and then a 20 minute to half hour break. And I'm hoping I will be able to basically have the car on the track and, you know, do something like 20 laps and come in and recharge the car and go back out and basically be out there for, you know, multiple
sessions,
multiple sessions, and not have to fill the car with gas, and
that's
hopefully
amazing.
Be able to, you know, charge there.
That's what I was going to ask. So you have a mobile charging setup? I mean, I know this is all still being figured out.
Yeah. Well, you know, there's some talk about maybe solar putting a battery in a trailer that I can hook up to like a Tesla charge station, so that I have batteries in the trailer. And that the trailer would have a solar component so that I could pull the car into the trailer and charge the car and also trickle charge the car off the sun's energy.
This is very interesting.
At Telefunken in South Windsor, I hope to be able to soon, hopefully, put solar on the roof of the building so that I can store some electricity in battery packs so that essentially you could create a zero footprint motorsports team to go out and race on the sun, which would be a game changer.
Holy cow. It just sounds fun to me.
It sounds so neat.
Even if this doesn't take over the rest of the world, it's going to be its own thing.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's going to be its own thing.
There isn't a group for it. I hope to create, you know, a, like there is for a drag racing association or whatever, association for people who are interested in converting cars, and
I can't even imagine what that is going to feel like.
You know, I'd like to try to keep it Porsche centric, but I'm sure what I'm doing will happen in a lot of other vehicles eventually.
I like where you're starting.
Yeah,
it's a neat way to attack what's coming up and just how to live differently in this cool world.
Yeah, I mean,
I love that you have the technology to do it.
I don't know. Part of me also connects to the sound. I know this won't be possible because, you know, Sundays are Sundays and they're religious days. But, you know, Lime Rock's always had this situation with noise. And my way of, you know...
Did you know that you can't race on Sunday at Lime Rock?
Thinking about that kind of thing and like, you know, okay, well, how could we do what we do and do it so it is less of an environmental impact and do it quietly? Well, the technology is there for that now. And I want to be the guy to kind of, not necessarily rush out there, but show people that it's possible, and to use that Telefunken.
Are you a dreamer?
To spark the imagination of that's what the transmitting the spark is all
beautiful.
About, right?
I could see where you were going.
Yeah, so,
oh gosh, that's so cool.
Yeah,
I'm so glad I know you. Like, I'm really excited for not only how we came to know each other, but that I do now know you.
Yeah,
I'm very curious to see where you take all of this.
I'm thankful to be here and the opportunity to be on your show and to come out here and speak from the heart, and completes the circuit, right? It's what the audience and the band feel, right? And to be able to be here and sit here with you and with these microphones and create and discuss dreams and, you know,
it's an opportunity, right? Like, what a wonderful opportunity.
Yeah.
It's a gift. You're incredibly positive. You talked about good vibrations and everything before. Were you always that way? Are you a happy person? Like, do you wake up just happy, or how does it work for you?
You know, I've been through a bunch of things in life. I like to think that I am positive. The Telefunken machine is a difficult one to run.
I imagine.
I'm learning as I go. I'm not going to mince my words. I have great days and I have not so great days. I try to create and imagine myself in those great moments and more of them, and make them possible.
That's awesome.
At home, I love being in the studio. I love it when the bands come in and record. I love being part of that. I love being part of a team.
So you know how to fulfill yourself, basically. You know how to. You've got enough things out there where I can poke from this one. I can pick from this one. Pick from this one.
Yeah.
Whatever it takes, maybe that day.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like yin and yang.
Yeah.
You can't have lightning bolts and the white part of the logo without like some darkness to surround it. You don't have the contrast.
Yeah.
So, I think that's what life is about, is, kind of like figuring out how to deal with that contrast and
bravo.
How it aligns with the stars, right? Like working with a guy in Connecticut now, helping me with a business plan forward for the next, 5, 7. Right now we're looking at 3 years and what we can really, really do. But, his business, he hit me to this thing that the sailors used to do with the stars, right? They find the lodestar. They find the star in the sky, which when they know where that is, right, they can point their way. They can find their path. And I think that is really what the Telefunken brand can be about, is changing the way people think, making good vibrations, getting gear where it needs to be, where the rubber hits the road, and whether it be rock and roll or motors and asphalt, I kind of like the idea of doing something to help people's perception of what's cool to do in motorsport and try something a little different. I know
bravo.
There are guys who, that doesn't sound like a 911. There will always be that. But
it is what it is.
We will find a way to make it sound good.
One of the last things I definitely want to talk about before you go, and I'm not trying to push you out, but you let me know. You mentioned one of your happy places being when the bands come into the studio.
Oh, yeah.
One of my favorite things on the internet is Live from the Lab. Can we talk about Live from the Lab for
Please.
A second?
Yes.
This is a series, I guess, for lack of a better term, that you and Telefunken can put on. It's got its own YouTube channel. They're done live from the studios in South Windsor.
Yeah.
That the bus that you talked about is actually generally in the shot sometimes.
Yep.
And the level of, not the level, I should say. I don't know how to say this. You have a very eclectic group of people who come in to play for you. And I don't know how this works, if they're coming to play for you, if they're coming to play for tape of their performance. I don't know how this works. the fidelity, the production value, the quality, the sound, everything is exceptional, to the point where I just put it on the big TV through the Apple TV and turn it up. And she's like, what is that? I'm like, oh, it's a Telefunken live from the lab. Listen to those horns, man. They're wailing. And she's like, that sounds so good.
It just resonates.
I can feel it.
Through the house. There you go. It is so cool.
Everyone who works there loves music or is involved with music. The whole thing is completely organic in how it grew.
How did it start?
Well, you know, the guys in the lab like playing music. So, like, it, you know, all right, we're going to make this microphone. We have to figure out what it sounds good on. We have to, you know, make adjustments. And
so it was a real lab to start.
Yeah. I mean, the microphones grew out of the lab, and the music is now growing out of the lab that surrounded the microphones to figure out whether or not we like the way they sounded
it?
On it's what they... It's pinch me, right? It's unbelievable.
Art, life.
it's really great.
It's good to be you, I hope.
You know, and
looking at you, it's good to be you. I hope it is.
In continuing with the whole Connecticut thing, you know, I really like the fact that I've been able to work with Connecticut and local artists, and that we're a company that's willing to hear or listen to anyone's story. And, you know, it's not just about dropping names.
Right.
It's about, you know, being in the right place at the right time. Have you seen this Alan Stone? It's one of the Live from the Labs.
Is it a recent one?
Yeah,
because I'm pretty caught up.
It's our most successful of all the Live from the Labs.
Okay, then
done
I'm sure
like
I've seen it.
Four seasons, and when he came in, I had no idea who he was. And then I was there for when they did the recording, and I knew that it was special when they recorded it, but seeing it finished and then seeing the response from the social media, I think it has over 200,000.
Oh my goodness.
Wow.
Most
That's fantastic.
Of our things get like, you know, 2,000 likes or maybe 20,000 likes. But to go into the, you know, 200,000 likes.
It's a different caliber.
It's great. I mean, I'm sure one day, hopefully, we'll keep, you know, growing and having other artists come. And,
well, we're going to talk about that too, because we want to do musical guests, and you've got a place and a setup and everything. So I think we're going to figure something out there.
Yeah,
pull it out.
Yeah. Well, he's got even bigger ideas. He's like, I want to do them out there, and we'll just get a place. And I'm like, oh, okay.
I like it.
That's Telefunken sponsored. Sounds great.
Been really positive, and I'm really excited to get back and after NAMM, kind of like get that stage
dialed in.
Yeah.
Good for
I mean,
you.
It's dialed. that's
well, you just redid the floors or something the other day.
Yeah, I like. You know, I'm very aware of like the aesthetic and how it feels for people. And we built product in that room on that floor for 15 years. There were literally like places where people sat with their chair and like it. You know,
they had a record release party there the other night with lights and fog and everything.
So
I mean, it was a huge deal.
We've you know gone through and cleaned it all up, and really now the soundstage is a soundstage, and it's less of a lab now. It's really we have to now develop this new thing, which will be, you know, how do we use this tool in Connecticut to kind of feature what we're doing and have it.
Well, can people rent it out? How do people?
Yeah,
I mean, we should make them know if
like
it's telephone accessible
out,
to them.
Like,
yeah,
to record there.
Yeah, yeah, they can come in.
Does it have to be music? This might be a silly question. I'm sorry,
no,
but I used
to
know
there,
do a lot of
wanna,
comedy stuff. Is
yeah,
that similar?
Talked to a few people that wanted to come in and rent the room to build a set.
That's what I was thinking. It's a very large
to
room.
Film. Yeah, well, it's a 50x50 room. The reality is the other side of the building, there's another 30,000 square feet there that I hope in a year or two could maybe even become a bigger soundstage.
Oh, wow.
So
seeing how this goes.
Yeah, baby steps.
I love it. You know, I just want to hug you nonstop.
Yeah.
Every answer is my favorite.
Yeah, they were, you know, for a little while, there was a group that was trying to start something like this Hollywood East. And
it's been in the works for over a decade.
So it's literally the land they were thinking about doing this is a stone's throw. It's like less than a quarter of a mile from Telefunken. And you know, the whole time I was reading about this in the paper, I'm like, we're already here.
We're already here.
You know, Horton gives a who, you know, we're like,
acknowledge us, just acknowledge.
We're here. There is somebody doing this. And you know, the state of Connecticut is funny in that everyone's kind of involved with politics and keeps blinders on, and It takes a certain type who go out and actually see a performance, you know, or go to a private party or something like that at our space. And, you know, when they see it, they're like,
why don't we do more stuff here?
Why does it sound so good? You know,
is that true?
You know, because it's
they're just not expecting it.
We just, you know, I love the fact that it's acoustically treated, and you know, like I feel like the guy from Jurassic Park. You know,
spared no expense.
But
Sir Tony Fishman,
we really, you know, that's the mentality of, but in a responsible, very responsible way to kind of like create an environment where musicians can come and use cool equipment and be happy and make good vibrations. And I think it's like about to explode.
I'm on board.
Yeah.
We are obviously doing everything we can to get the name out there. What else can we do to help you?
If you're interested in what's going on with Telefunken Motorsports, Telefunken Motorsports website, telefunkenmotorsports.com. There are some pictures of the project there under the electromotors section.
I spent some time there last night. The RSR is there. You can see it. Like the electric one that you're talking about.
Yeah,
you can see it.
Yeah, yeah. Lots of pictures. Every picture from the beginning of the project to the end of the project will be published there. There are other cars there that are some of my tributes and resto mods. I like sort of backdating 964s and stuff
that
like that.
Where do you keep your cars? Are you able to keep them at home, or do you have keep them at Telefunken, I guess?
A couple of them are at my home. I have a small shop in Plainville, Connecticut. It's a private shop by appointment only.
What do you mean you have a small shop?
I have a...
Is this another little side?
Yeah, Telefunken Motorsports has, three bays. There are about 20 cars there.
I didn't realize that. Good for you.
And I hope to move that to South Windsor at some point.
Good for you.
I'm hoping that the Electro Project will allow people to see that we're capable of much more, and that this passion needs to not be...
There are a few people out there. We've gone to a handful of cars and coffee places where you'll find somebody who converted a 912 or a 911, and they're driving them. I mean, I can't speak to what they are or whatever, but there at least are some people out there who are already ready.
The interest
for this,
is there. The curiosity is there. It's definitely a good time to get into that.
Yeah. Well, this car should be unique in that we are doing it so that the motor will truly run on 500 volts. It's not detuned. So we're going to get whatever that Tesla motor is capable of. We will see what that is like in a lightweight 911 RSR shell.
It's really neat.
I think it's going to be a 2-second car.
Wouldn't it have to be if you can get it to connect?
If I can get it to hook up in the right temperature with the right tires, I think it'll be a 2-second car.
But shouldn't you have a bigger advantage because of where that placement is over those rear wheels than even Tesla?
I think so.
Yeah, I think so too. I think you're in good shape. I think you're in really good shape. Yeah. You may have to detune this thing.
So I'm
for you.
Really curious to see what happens with that. And, you know, I don't know if there's ever been a 911 that's had a 0-60 in 2 seconds.
I don't need one. That's crazy. I'm scared. I'm not going to drive it that fast. I can't wait to drive it, but I can't wait to take it up in the canyons.
I hope I'm...
Hopefully you're going to do some West Coast testing.
Qualified. Yeah, I would really love to. You know, the problem with the snow back there, I got to find a way to be out here with the cars.
Did you buy that? I know you were thinking about it. Did you get a Beck replica 50?
We've been talking 550? About that for years.
Okay,
all right. And there was one actually about 2 years ago that was in the basement of the Peterson Museum. That was an Alloy 550. Replica.
Oh, whoa.
That I almost
was the scale
pulled the trigger on.
Was the scale the same, or was it,
replica
scale?
It was really, really, really close. The little blip behind the headrest, that little arrow thing that they had on there, which is removable.
Yeah, the little cone.
Yeah,
the aerodynamic.
I didn't think the size of that was right, but, you know.
But overall.
It's hard because they're not a lot, like, all the 550 replicas are of later cars. And the 54, if you look at it, the hood is different in the front and unique to that car. But
I have a feeling you'll figure it out.
Yeah.
He's like, nah, it's not a problem.
The wheels just turn, and then like you're like, oh, no,
yeah,
I'll deal with it.
I've been thinking about this for 30 years. It's not a problem.
Yeah.
I think a lightweight car especially one, you know, fiberglass, like a kit like that.
Yeah.
That would be electric, that you could build in your garage.
You're saying all the right things.
Would be like, you know.
If it's got my little name on here that I love so much, that'll be really cool.
You know, I think.
You're onto something, man.
I think that's something I'd like to do.
Microphones, Porsches, classic and electric, Grateful Dead, Connecticut, Live from the Lab, Good Vibrations, and thedreamride.org. We got everything on my list. How do you feel?
I feel great.
You are awesome.
Yeah.
I mean that.
Thank you.
It means a lot to us that you have taken a chance on some people you didn't know. It means a lot to us that you came out here and are sitting in that chair in front of us to get to know us. And I'm really very optimistic and enthusiastic about a future, whatever that might be.
Yeah. I hope this is the first of many, many visits back. And, you know, we'll see if you guys want to. I'll send you that footage of the car when it runs.
Oh, you may kidding.
Yeah.
We're going to let everybody know.
The guys are working as we speak, I think, on building the charger for it. You build a car like that. And that's the part that I, the Achilles heel, if you will, we got a little caught up on focusing all the energy in the car and not thinking about the charger so much. So that's what's going on right now. And I apologize for not having the footage of the car running.
I can't read it, but what's it say? Oh my gosh, important.
Mention that, yeah.
Hey, we're wrapping it up here. May as well talk about the Holocaust. No, this is important, actually. This is important, and it goes very deep for you.
Grew up, my mom was a Holocaust survivor, and my grandfather and grandmother and uncle and mother were very lucky to survive. My sister has written a great book about sort of our family story and their exodus from Germany to Holland, and then what happened sort of after the war.
What's the book?
The book is called Tootie's Promise.
Okay.
It's available on Amazon. Right. Heidi Fishman is the author. And it is a really amazing story.
Also ties into you and why you're...
Yeah. You know, the Telefunken brand was founded in 1903. And, of course, around World War II, Adolf Hitler kind of took this brand to begin expressing messages of hate, you know.
As it did with so many things.
Yeah. You know, 1936 Olympics was the first Olympic broadcast. You know, I think there's like a scene in...
Contact,
right?
Yeah, they sent it to space.
The first
man-made broadcast to space, yeah.
Like, vibrations are really important to me. And so... the fact that this brand was kind of taken to do something like that, I'm on a mission to make
sure... You wanted to bring it back.
...that it is here for good vibrations only. I want to do something to cancel out that negative part of maybe how it was used.
Yeah.
And to make sure that, you know, people know that it's a Jewish family in Connecticut...
With a Holocaust survivor as the matriarch.
Yeah, who are very aware of wanting to spread good vibrations and change the world through the power of broadcast and music.
Man, now I really want to hug you.
Yeah.
It's the same thing we want to do. It's, you know, the whole thing, just taking your positivity and putting it out there. That is an awesome, it's an awesome story. Thank you for sharing it.
Yeah.
Goes deep with you. Goes real deep.
Yeah, it's all connected, and I'm really grateful. Such good friends, and opportunity galore, right? You know.
Absolutely.
I love it.
This is the beginning of many. It's the first of many. I don't even know what that means.
It better be.
It is the first of many. Yeah.
Agreed.
Mrs. Ryan, this has been like one of those religious experiences.
Yeah.
You remember somebody used to say that about Breakfast Club. Blah, blah, blah. Having breakfast with these people is like a religious experience.
Oh, yeah.
That's what this whole thing sort of was. Yeah. Usually it's me with I'm the one who's heavier with the stuff and with the backstory and everything. And now I get somebody else to sit here and I can sort of geek out on their story for a little bit. It's it's exciting for me.
Yeah, it's been very neat.
I love you, Mrs. Ryan.
I love you, too.
Speaking of, though, I love you, Mrs. Ryan. We love you, Tony Fishman. We love you at home. Let's see. Tomorrow, we've got Al. I don't know how to say this last name.
Ducharme.
It is. Al Ducharme, comedian. Thursday, we've got Stephanie Curtis from Brass Knuckles. That'll be fun.
Yeah.
And in the meantime, like I said, I love you. I love you.
Love you.
We love everybody at home. Love one another. And see you guys tomorrow. Have a great night.
See you soon, mister.
This is so much fun for us. Have a great night, everybody.